Assalamu alaikum. This is Dr. Fatima, and today, as I mentioned in the previous video of introduction to monitoring during anesthesia, today we are going to discuss pulse oximetry, which is the component under respiratory system monitoring. Let's not waste time and start discussion. Okay, so we are going to discuss today what is pulse oximeter, what principle does it follow, what is the mechanism of action, and what equipment it uses. What are the advantages, disadvantages, and complications? Guys, I have divided pulse oximetry into two episodes. This is the first episode, and in the next episode, I will tell you what we are going to discuss. So start with the discussion. What is a pulse oximeter, or what is pulse oximetry? Basically, pulse oximeter is a monitoring device which monitors and measures the peripheral arterial oxygen saturation as a surrogate marker for tissue oxygenation. It has become the standard for continuous non-invasive assessment of oxygenation and is often considered as the fifth vital sign. So basically, pulse oximeter is a surrogate measure of SaO2, which is the arterial saturation of hemoglobin. But because it is using the arterial blood, which is pulsatile flow, which is having the pulsatile flow, so it is also called as SpO2 for the component which we measure from pulse oximeter. What is the principle and what is the mechanism? Well, it takes two things. It takes Beer-Lambert law, and it also follows spectrophotometry. Starting with Beer-Lambert law, this law states that the absorption of the light of a given wavelength passing through a non-absorbing solvent which contains an absorbing solute is proportional to the product of the solute concentration, light path length, and an extinction coefficient. Now, what did I say? I said that when a light passes through a medium which is a solution which contains a solvent and a solute, but the solution as a whole is transmitting solution, but it contains some solute which is absorbing the light, which is not transmitting the light. So the proportion of the light which is going to transmit through that particular medium is going to be dependent upon three factors. And what are these factors? These are the solute concentration, for example blood in our situation, the light path length, and the extinction coefficient. The equation is I trans is equal to I in E into negative dc eta. And here I trans is the intensity of the transmitted light, I in is the intensity of the incident light, E is the base of natural logarithm, D is the distance of which the light is going to travel through the medium, C is the concentration of the solute, and E is the extinction coefficient. The second thing which is applied in pulse oximetry is spectrophotometry. This is basically the chemistry principle. And what does it say? It is basically the quantitative measurement of a reflection or transmission properties of the material as a function of wavelength. So basically it measures the wavelength of the light. Now this is a pictorial presentation of Beer-Lambert law. You can see on the left side we have got the light intensity IO, and then we have got a medium in which you can see the blood cells in an orangish red color. And then on the other side, there is some light which has been passed through that particular medium and it has crossed a certain distance, which is depicted here by D. So this is the pictorial presentation of Beer-Lambert law. What equipment and mechanism it uses? Basically, what happens that the pulse oximeter has got a probe, and this probe has got two components. Probe is the pulse oximeter probe consists of two light emitting diodes and a photo detector. Now the emitters, they emit the light. The deoxygenated hemoglobin absorbs the light maximally in the red band of spectrum, which is 600 to 750 nanometers. Keep it in mind, these are asked in the MCQs or in any Viva, anywhere in the world. So basically what happens is that the deoxygenated hemoglobin, it absorbs light at this wavelength, which is 600 to 750 nanometer, and the oxyhemoglobin absorbs maximally in the infrared band, which is 850 to 1000 nanometer. Thus the emitters emit the light at 660 nanometer and 940 nanometer for optimal detection of these two substances, the deoxyhemoglobin and the oxyhemoglobin, and their difference. What does the detector do? The detector, also known as sensor, it detects the absorbance of the light from the exposed tissue, and the values are processed, and then a saturation is determined by the microprocessor. So measurement of the degree of the arterial hemoglobin saturation. What happens is that first is the absorption of the light at two different wavelengths by hemoglobin differs depending on the proportion of the hemoglobin molecules which are oxygenated or deoxygenated, you know. By calculating the absorption at two different wavelengths, which are 660 and 940 nanometers, the processor can compute the proportion of the hemoglobin that is oxygenated. Second thing which we need to know is that the light signal following the transmission through the tissue has a pulsatile component, of course, the arterial component of the blood, as well as it has got a non-pulsatile component and other things. And this can be distinguished by the processor from a non-pulsatile component, which is resulting from venous, capillary, and tissue light absorption. We can see in this picture. What happens? This picture is showing you two particular things. It is showing you an area which is having direct current, which is DC, and an alternating current, which is AC. Guys, keep it in mind, the only portion which is pulsatile component, which is absorption due to the pulsatile arterial blood, it is only creating the alternating current due to the pulsatility. The rest of the component, which is absorption due to the non-pulsatile arterial blood and absorption due to the venous and capillary blood, as well as the heart tissue or the soft tissues which are around the artery, they all emit the DC current, not the AC current. So what we get? This is R to IR ratio. And what is this? This is basically red to infrared ratio. What does it mean? Guys, basically this is the ratio of the AC and DC current of the red light and AC and DC current of the infrared light, or we can also write it down as perception of their wavelengths. What does it do is that the ratio R to IR is empirically related to the oxygen saturation on the calibration curve, which is internal to each pulse oximeter, and it varies according to the pulse oximeter. We have got a spectrum, a calibration spectrum in this graph. You can see that at 0.4 R to IR ratio, the SpO2 is 100%, and at 3.4 R to IR ratio, the SpO2 is 0%. And what is the critical limit? That is 1. If R to IR ratio is 1, the SpO2 will be around 85. Now we have to see what information we can get from a pulse oximeter. Well, a pulse oximeter does not only provide you a heart rate or SpO2, it also provides you a waveform. And also, on many pulse oximeters which we use in anesthesia, in ORs, they have got waveforms and a sound which is synchronized by the heart rate. I mean, when a pulse is generated from the heart, that there is a sound which is produced by the monitor, by the pulse oximeter. And if there is bradycardia, you can hear that sound to be slowed down. If there is tachycardia, you can hear that sound to be getting fast. What does waveform tell you? That the waveform also tells you, also lets you hear the sound. The pitch of the sound is directly proportional to the saturation. One pitch, by listening to one pitch, I cannot understand that what is the SpO2 without watching at the monitor. But yes, If there is some abrupt change in the pitch of sound which is being produced by the pulse oximeter, yes, I can imagine that there is a change in SpO2. For example, if there is a high pitch sound, there may be the saturation may be 98 or 97%, and the pitch is going to get increased. The saturation may be increased. For example, it goes from 98 to 100%. When the pitch is getting reduced, the saturation is also reducing, and this is the sign. This is a safety feature that you cannot, you don't have to see the monitor, and you just pick one abnormal thing, and that's a safety feature in pulse oximeter. Now we have got advantages. Basically, it's a rapid device. It can tell you the saturation within a few seconds. The condition is that you are not moving the limb or you are not moving the area from which you have put a pulse oximeter. The other thing is that it is a non-invasive device. You don't have to go for an ABG sample, which is, yes, although it's a very good thing that you get so many pieces of information from the ABGs, but they are invasive. They give patient certain pain. But on contrary, the pulse oximeter is non-invasive and painless, so it's a good thing about it. The other good thing is that it provides a continuous data, as I told you that when you place a pulse oximeter on any part of the body, for example, on the finger, on the toe, on the foot of the baby, on the penis of the baby, on the ear lobe of any person. So what does it do? It gives you a continuous data with your heart rate. This is the best thing that you are getting the pulse to pulse variation of saturation. The other particular thing is that it is available in the portable variants as well, which has been shown in the figure as well. This is a portable variant of pulse oximeter. You can use it in out of OR procedures. You can use it anywhere in the hospital. You can use it while you are transferring the patient from one area of within the hospital to the other area within the hospital, or from without the hospital to within the hospital. We have got certain limitations as well. And what are these limitations? Well, yes, it does tell you that patient is getting hypoxic, but it does not tell you that the patient is got hyperoxic. For example, it tells you SpO2, but it does not accurately tell you the SaO2. If you got ABGs and SaO2 is certainly high, the saturation will be showing as 100%. Nonetheless, SaO2 may be high. And in cases of COPD or in cases of obstructive sleep apnea, if the patient is hyperoxic, he is going to get worse. So it does not tell you that particular thing. What else is that? It does not tell you the arterial oxygen tension, yes, because this is not about the this is only about the saturation, hemoglobin oxygen saturation. This is not about the dissolved component of the blood of oxygen. What else? It has got inability to tell you tissue oxygenation because it is a pulsatile thing. It is only featuring the pulsatile blood which is running through your arteries and which is giving you the oxygen saturation. It is not telling you what is the oxygen saturation within the tissues, within the cell. So this is a limitation as well. The other thing is inability to measure the ventilation and acid-base status. It is telling you heart rate. It is telling you saturation of hemoglobin, but it is not telling you if the patient is breathing or not. It is not telling you the end-tidal carbon dioxide. So we have got other monitors. We need other monitors as well to measure the ventilation. It is only for one component of oxygenation. The other particular thing is many conditions which are there which can give erroneous readings. We are going to discuss these particular conditions and their troubleshooting in the next video. There are a few complications, but they are very rare. Local complications are extremely rare, especially when compared with the arterial blood gas monitoring. Digital injury has been reported on a rare occasion in critically ill patients, although it is more likely that the injury is due to the underlying poor digital perfusion and or use of the vasopressor in the critically ill patients in intensive care units. Well, burns have also been reported while doing MRI. No permanent adverse events have occurred or have reported as yet. Thank you very much. Kindly subscribe and share and wait for the episode 2 of Pulse Oximeter. In the next video, we are going to do application of the pulse oximetry, interpretation of the results. I mean, how we have to interpret different results which pulse oximetry is giving you. For example, waveforms, different waveforms, their clinical values, and sources of error, which I have just mentioned in the limitations, which sources are there which cause erroneous reading in a pulse oximeter and how we can troubleshoot them. And then we will go and discuss the summary of the whole discussion. Thank you so much.